Rhabdomyolysis literally means muscle fiber death, and it often occurs when people do too much physical activity. I've been investigating rhabdo for over 10 years and been teaching people about it, and lately I've noticed it's getting a lot of attention in the news media. While I'm very happy to hear that, I'm still hearing a lot of misinformation about this medical disorder. So, as the author of the first book ever written on exercise-induced rhabdomyolysis, I want to try to lay to rest the five most common myths about rhabdomyolysis that I think most people believe are true. So, this is going to be a quick video. Let's jump right into it and see what we can see. Myth number one, drinking water prevents rhabdo. There are people out there who say if you're working out, all you got to do is drink water, stay hydrated, and you won't get rhabdo. That's not true. It's a myth. As I often tell people, drinking water does not stop muscle fiber death. Rhabdomyolysis occurs when your need for energy exceeds your ability to make it, and this causes a breakdown in the structural integrity of your muscle fibers, releasing their contents into the bloodstream. This is going to cause a lot of bad stuff happening, as we'll talk about. Drinking water by itself is not going to stop this process from occurring, and that's why I often suggest that people think they have rhabdo, they got to get checked out by a physician. So let's lay this one to rest right away. Drinking water is not going to stop the process. When people talk about water, they're only thinking about the kidneys. They're thinking about keeping the kidneys flushed because they've heard of kidney problems with rhabdo. That's going to bring us to our next myth, and it's the kidneys. The thinking here is rhabdomyolysis only damages the kidneys. Again, that's not true, but this is the side effect a lot of people have heard about. They've heard about people who go into the gym and they get rhabdo and they end up with kidney problems. They may be on dialysis for a little bit of time. And that's what gives rise to, if you just drink a lot of water, you'll be okay. I want you to know that rhabdo is a multi-organ process. It can affect, for instance, your heart. Your heart may start to beat irregularly. And in extreme cases, this could even lead to a heart attack, okay? Many people are not aware that rhabdomyolysis can also elevate your liver enzymes. Again, drinking water is not gonna help your heart problems or your liver problems. And then we also have to consider that when people have rhabdo, they often experience sometimes significant swelling of the arms and legs that may even require surgery to alleviate. And people often report a horrific muscle pain. Again, I want to try to dispel the myth that rhabdo is only affecting the kidneys. It's a multi-organ phenomenon. And that's, again, why I'm recommending people don't sit there in silence and watch YouTube videos of so-called experts who tell them to drink a lot of water and they'll be okay. It is highly recommended that you get to a doctor and get checked out by a medical professional. Now, myth number three, your urine must change color. So the most commonly understood side effect of rhabdomyolysis is that someone's urine is going to change color. It could look like what you're seeing here, often described as looking like iced tea or cola colored. I want you to realize that there's a spectrum of color changes that could occur depending on the degree of rhabdo you're experiencing. It could look lighter than you're seeing here, or as dark as a cola-colored beverage that you may have drank or maybe in your kitchen right now. Regardless of the fact, people often use this urine color change as a litmus test for rhabdomyolysis. I want you to know that's not always going to happen. You can have rhabdomyolysis and not see a change in the color of your urine. So please do not use this as a litmus test for rhabdo. You don't have to have a change in the color of your urine, you could still have rhabdo. Again, gets back to let's get checked out by a medical professional. So let's lay this one to myth to rest, because this is actually a very huge misunderstanding, especially in the fitness community. Myth number four, rhabdo is a short-term problem. I think people just don't take rhabdo seriously. As I go on, say, you know, social media and I look at, say, hashtag rhabdo, I see people thinking, it's no big deal. You know, you get rhabdo, you go to the hospital, you come home, you're good to go in about a week or so. Not so. I have encountered multiple people over the years who've told me of sometimes long-term issues after getting rhabdo. For instance, fatigue that sometimes could last for many months after they were discharged from the hospital. Sometimes people tell me they get up and their blood pressure drops, preventing them from carrying out their daily activities. They just don't want to exercise again because the fatigue is so great. Other people have told me that when they do go back to exercise, even a little bit, like walking on the treadmill for about 20 minutes, causes their legs to once again start to swell up again. Again, where's that coming from? Again, we have to realize sometimes people will deal with long-term issues after getting this condition. And then we have the medical bills. Depending on what your insurance looks like, you may be hit with thousands of dollars in medical bills from the time you spent in the hospital. So we have to consider that as well. How long is it going to take you to pay off those medical bills? And then lastly, I want to call attention to something that nobody's addressing. And that is what I believe is a post-traumatic stress syndrome after people get rhabdo. I say this because over the years, people have told me the same thing over and over again. I've never heard of this condition before. It was the worst pain I've ever experienced, and I'm terrified to exercise again. These are individuals who like to exercise, but they're afraid to again because they don't want to try to trigger rhabdo from occurring once again in their bodies. And so they stop exercising. So long term, what does that mean? We all know the benefits of exercise. What happens when people don't exercise? Well, lack of exercise increases the risk of heart disease and cancer and diabetes. You get that. So again, people being afraid to exercise is a topic that nobody is talking about out there, with the exception of me. And so I want you to realize that this is not a short-term phenomenon. There are people dealing with problems associated with rhabdomyolysis, sometimes for a very long time. And then we come to the fifth myth. And this one is also very prevalent. Only intense activity or exercise causes rhabdo. People are under the impression that you're only going to get rhabdomyolysis if you go into the military or you're a Navy SEAL or a Marine or if you take part in hardcore exercise classes. I want you to know that's not always the case either. I have met people, for instance, who've told me they've gotten rhabdo from painting a room or from gardening, for instance, activities which most people would not consider as quote unquote intense. So what's the research show on this? Well, if we go back to 1998, this is one of the first things I've ever seen when I started investigating rhabdo, rectus abdominis rhabdomyolysis after sit-ups. Here's basically a 29-year-old guy who's healthy. He does 30 to 40 sit-ups a day for 5 days, winds up in a hospital with rhabdo. What's up with that? Okay, so he's not the only one though. Here's another investigation, 2015, low intensity repetitive exercise induced rhabdomyolysis. Again, we've got a healthy 23-year-old woman who performs low intensity, high repetition bicep curls. What kind of weight was she using? 10 to 15 pound weights. That's it. Now, problem with this report here, like a lot of reports are not perfect, we don't know the volume of activity she was doing. We don't know, for instance, the reps she was doing. We don't know how many sets she was doing. So for all we know, she could have been doing 5 sets of 50 reps, which again is a lot for anybody. But it points out that even low weight, 10 to 15 pounds, which is not a lot for most people, can induce this in some individuals. The other point I want to point out here was an individual who took a break from exercise. She was out of the gym for several months. Many people will take time out the gym. They maybe go away for summer, whatever. They come back, say, 4, 5, 6 months later, and they go back and they try to do the same thing they did 4, 5, 6 months before. No, that when you do things you're not used to, and after taking several months off, a lot of stuff is going to be brand new to you. You got to relearn these activities. You've atrophied in, say, 4, 5, 6 months. So going back and doing the same thing you were doing, say, 6 months prior could trigger this. So I think possibly in this case, it was maybe the volume of activity she was doing, too much reps and too many sets, coupled with the fact that she took several months off from the gym. That's probably what caused it in this case. And then, for instance, we've got this other one, white collar rhabdomyolysis with kidney problems. Again, white collar is a reference that I don't see very often, but it refers to office workers, educated office workers who start an exercise program and they overdo it, hence the name white collar. But again, we've got a 26-year-old woman, she's healthy, she's doing 108 sit-ups. My guess is, and it kind of says here, unaccustomed exercise, she was probably not used to doing sit-ups, and then right out of the gate, did 108 reps. Again, that's too much. You don't start with 108 repetitions of anything. You start with maybe 10, and then you slowly over time you build up the repetitions. Again, the key thing to remember here is it's not just intense exercise that can cause rhabdo. Even lower intensity activities, things that most people would not think is a lot, could trigger it as well. So guys, I hope this really helped you out. I know there's a lot of misinformation out there about rhabdomyolysis. I'm going to put my full review of this in the description so you can see the references I used for this video. If you've had rhabdo and you want some help, leave a comment below or on my website and I'll help you personally. Until next time, I'm Joe Cannon. Take care out there.